Let me get here on the chat too.
How's it going? It's Margaret, and we are here hosting the Merch Minds podcast live tonight with Glen and Yong. Why don't you guys introduce yourselves?
Glen, you want to go first? Go ahead, man.
Sure.
My name is Glen with the YouTube channel Hustler Hacks, and this is episode number 8 of the Merch Minds podcast. We're doing this thing live with Margaret and Yong.
All right. Hey, guys, this is Yong coming to you from San Jose, California. I just got home. It's freezing outside. That's why I still have my jacket on. I have the heater on, but I don't know. It still needs to warm up a bit. But, yeah, it's good to see you guys, Margaret. Glen, welcome back from your wedding slash honeymoon.
Yeah, thank you, congratulations.
Thank you.
Awesome, awesome. Cool.
So I was telling the guys before the show started, I was so bummed this morning because I was out of Merch Minds podcast. I listen on iTunes, and I'm one of those that you need to slap my hand because I haven't gone over and left a comment yet. But I was so upset this morning that I didn't have any more Merch Minds to listen to when I was walking. So,
yeah, well, for everyone that's watching and in the near future that'll be listening, so this is a collaboration between us and Margaret. So you guys will get the video portion on Margaret's channel, and then once this goes live, we'll extract the audio, and then we'll upload the audio to our iTunes. So yeah, so the latest podcast will be up and running here in the next couple of days, hopefully.
Awesome.
Very nice. So you want to start off a little bit about your merch numbers for November. I think the last time, at least we talked about it in the podcast, my numbers were up and down, but honestly, for the last 3 days or so, they have been probably the best they've been in the last 2 months. I think the last 3 days might have to do with the little purge that they had. Maybe they're starting to get rid of them. I don't know. But November has been a little bit better for me. Right now, I'm about like 225 sales per week. And I think before that, last month, I think I was like at one. The lowest it had ever been was like 140-something, 150-something. So it's starting to come back up. And maybe it has something to do with Q4. I don't know.
140 a week?
That was like last month and a half. It was like 140 a week. And then right now I'm back up to like 220 a week.
Wow.
Of sales.
Wow.
That's so odd. But see, this is the thing. When I hear those numbers, I don't get discouraged. I get so encouraged. I'm just like, I see your numbers. I see some other guys' numbers. And I just get so excited. Like, this is a possibility.
Well, let me discuss my numbers with you guys. So So Glen and I were talking, I think it was yesterday or Monday, and I was a little bummed out because my numbers had dipped as far as daily sales. I'm not talking the overall number. Yesterday I think I had like 2 sales, and I think Monday I had like 3, which is well below the average for me, and I was just kind of bummed out. I was like, what the heck is going on? But today's been better. To kind of forecast my numbers, I'm on pace to do about $1,200. That would be my royalty. That would be my take home.
And that would be your highest of the whole time.
That would be my highest as of yet.
Of all time.
Of all time.
Okay. And awesome.
But here's the thing. Every time I do a forecast like that, by the end of the month, my numbers dip. So I'm hoping I didn't just jinx myself by trying to forecast my number. But so my daily sales are back up as of today. I'm on pace to do about 1,200 at the end of the month. I was maxed out at 500 shirts, but because of the purge, I think I'm at 437 now. So
nice.
Okay. Very nice. There you go.
Okay. So I'm actually on pace to do a little more than I have done the last couple months. The last 2 months I've made about $600 in royalties. I generally average about 3 shirts a day, but this month I've had a couple days where there were like 7 shirts, 9 shirts, and for me that's a big deal. Nice. You know, So it started, but then the last couple of days it's kind of tapered off. I'm such a nerd about it. I keep a Google spreadsheet. So every night, like, I enter in my numbers so I can tally up how many I've sold for the month and tally up.
Oh my gosh.
I know, I'm such a nerd about it. But it makes me sound like Scrooge McDuck. I'm so happy about, like, my numbers.
Oh, that's awesome. That's awesome. So are you at, what level are you at right now?
500. Yeah.
500.
So if I continue at this rate, then I will have sold 500 shirts by the end of the year. So, but who knows what they're, you know, the merch gods are going to do what they're going to do on bumping people up, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Cause I know, from the Facebook groups, people, who are supposed to have been, upgraded to the next tier, they haven't. And right. from what I'm seeing, I mean, people are waiting like a month, maybe even two.
Yeah.
So
I know some people that are well over the 100 mark. You know, Joe was well over the 100 mark, and he's still.
Oh, that's right. That's right. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, you know, speaking of Joe, we're totally kind of getting off track here, but we were supposed to have interviewed him. I think it was about a week or two ago, and he was having internet issues. So, my apologies to Joe, man. We'll have you back on here shortly.
Yeah, yeah. He and I have been doing a little more collabing on merch stuff. Can I throw that out there? He started a group called the Merch by Amazon University, like Facebook group. Then I kept having people ask me in my group, my thrifting group, do you have another merch group? And so I just said, hey, Joe, let's get together. Let's make it happen. Yeah. Not in that way, but in the merch way, you know.
Yeah. Cool. So, So Glen, I mean, so what have you done? I mean, cause I know when you and I talked, you're like, man, I haven't done anything and my numbers have dropped, but you're still making like a significant income.
Yeah, and that's what makes merch just so awesome is just that. So I just got married, went on my honeymoon. While I was out on the honeymoon, during those 4 or 5 days, I was still selling shirts. And that's like the cool thing about it is just having, you know, because I said it in my videos before too. There's no way passive income exists. Like, you know, I can't just sit on the beach, go to Vegas or go do something and chill and expect money to just come into my account. But merch can do that for you because, you know, we're not shipping anything out. We're not trying to find products to sell. And, you know, we're not taking pictures of items and listing all that stuff on there. We're just listing the design and it's selling either organically or if you're running ads or something. But, you know, overall my sales have dipped, but I haven't added any new shirts in probably like a month or so. And they have declined a little bit. But overall, I mean, I have nothing to complain about. It's just like an awesome opportunity that Amazon is pretty much, you know, giving us. But I don't know. I have nothing to complain about. But that's just kind of like my, I guess, little story of making money behind the scenes.
Well, I was explaining this to my son tonight. I know it may be off topic, but we were sitting there doing homework and he was saying, I want to buy this Lego set. And I was like, you need to make some money. And he's like, well, you make money making shirts. I want to make a shirt. I said, okay, what do you want to make? So then of course, like his stalling, not getting his homework done, we sit there and make a shirt, but it took us not very long. He made this shirt design. We popped it up on Amazon. It's live already and we'll see. But then when he was seeing the royalties, he was like, no, I want at least $5.
Oh gosh. That's funny. That is hilarious. But so since we are in Q4, are you guys doing anything as far as, I mean, are you guys designing holiday shirts? Have you guys I know you guys had briefly talked about your sales. I mean, do you think like a lot of your sales are from like the holiday themed shirts?
Not mine.
Yeah, because I haven't sold any holiday themed shirts.
I honestly am just like, I'm not gonna go there because I looked at how many holiday shirts are up. I mean, I would be swimming in a sea of, you know, holiday shirts. But I started looking at things around that, like what's going on. Okay, I'm gonna throw this out there. Hunting season's on, y'all. And then,
really?
And so, yeah, I was like, okay, I made a hunting.
Okay.
And I put it over on Instagram. That shirt's got like 50, 60 likes on Instagram, but it's got no sales yet.
Oh yeah, no, I've talked about this too. I mean, I have a shirt that damn nearly went viral on Instagram. It has like over 100 likes.
Yeah.
And I haven't sold one.
That's all, like, in the comments, like, y'all, this shirt's for sale.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. So how about you, Glen? Do you have any holiday shirts, and have you sold any? Do you see a spike in sales because of Q4, you think?
Well, since I just got back, I haven't added any new shirts, but I'm currently working on like holiday, Christmas type of shirts. And I think that's going to be the next thing, you know, that should be able to do well, especially coming up in the next 2 weeks or so. And so looking at the chat, want to say hi to Tanya, you can see. But everybody, I think if you have questions, I think we can answer them like while we're talking about some of the other like Q4 and some of the other stuff we were kind of wanted to address, because I think Q4 and almost like management, like we talk about managing multiple platforms. Mm-hmm. I think that's going to be like a huge thing, because, you know, me and Margaret are doing YouTube and I love doing YouTube videos, but when you're adding that and merch and eBay and, you know, my Etsy, I haven't even added anything to Etsy in a good while. My FBA has, like, last year at this point, FBA was kind of crazy for me. I was just like 100% into it. Mm-hmm. And then now merch has like completely changed that. And it's kind of crazy though, because, you know, like we talked about before, this didn't really exist, you know, in the last, and you know what, year to year and 2 months or so.
Right.
So, I don't know. It's just crazy how much opportunity is there. And now it's kind of like, well, now we're going to have to decide, like, what do you really want to work on? And it's really, really difficult to kind of figure that out, which I kind of wanted to talk about and see what you guys are doing, kind of like what Yang was saying. So, but maybe a mixture of that and a couple of questions that have already kind of come in.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, absolutely.
Well, I mean, for me, so I've been doing FBA for, 7 years now, I think, 8 years. I've been reselling since I was a little kid. I mean, since I was 15. You guys don't need to know my age, so don't even go there. but trust me, I've been doing this for a long time. But when, like Glen said, when the merch opportunity came, I saw the overall opportunity of how we can scale and make t-shirts. And plus, you know, for Glen and I, this is something that we went to school for, as far as, you know, doing graphic design and stuff. And so I just thought this would be a good opportunity to do something that I'm kind of passionate about, right? I'm, again, you know, I went to college for something like this. So I guess to make a long story short, my primary focus as of now is on merch by Amazon. Okay. I'm not quitting FBA. Trust me. You know, again, I've been doing FBA for a long time. I've been reselling, you know, for a long time, but it's on the back burner. And I understand we are in Q4 and, you know, during Q4, you know, this is when we make the most money for FBA, you know, with toys. And I mean, you guys know, I mean, just about everything sells on Amazon during Q4. So at some point I'm going to have to take advantage. I'm probably, in fact, I know I am going to go out this weekend and do my first retail arbitrage of the holiday season. So that'll be this weekend. But again, my primary focus is merch, and it's paid off. I mean, for someone who's only been doing this for less than a year now, I mean, to go from, like, I don't know, I don't remember, like $5 for my first payout to going on to $1,200 at the end of this month.
Awesome.
That's a huge accomplishment.
Yeah.
Yeah. And before we talk about, I guess, like, you want to talk a little bit about yourself, and then we'll go to markets as far as like what you're doing or what you're selling on, and if you're full time or not, where you're, like, you know, how many hours you're putting in at work, balancing like family and things. You know, all this comes into play, and of course, everybody's like in different situations. And you have to, you know, do what you want to do, what you're happy. Because if you're not happy, you're not going to go 110% into it. But maybe if you guys want to share a little bit about that too, and how many things you're balancing, and maybe what you're thinking about if you're going to cut anything out, or maybe things are going to be on hold. I know Mike told us on the last a show you guys did with Mike and Joe. Mike was saying that his eBay was pretty much, well, he still had things listed, but he hadn't added anything new in a good while. Yeah. It was almost like on hold now that merch came up. So maybe you guys want to talk a little bit about that. We'll just kind of go in a circle.
Sure. Margaret, you want to go first?
Sure. I mean, if you follow my channel for a while, you know that I am quote unquote a part-timer, but you know, I'm a full, I started staying home. I taught, I don't have a graphic design background like you guys are. So I was a teacher for 14 years and I started staying home to be with my boys. And then my mom took sick. And so just like taking care of my kids, taking care of my mom, trying to bring in extra income a little bit, you know? So for me, I started reselling in that, you know, at that point. But then merch was, it's so, I don't know, like intoxicating, you know, that, I don't know what else to describe it. Just there's, the opportunity is so amazing with merch that a lot, for me, a lot of other things have started slipping. I'm not listing as much on eBay. And every time I mention it to my husband, like, okay, you know, I really need to set aside some time to get this stuff listed. He says, how about that Amazon pile? Because I do have this pile of stuff I need to send in to Amazon. I just need to send it in, yeah. You know, but I'm spending so much time focusing on, you know, merch or, you know, and for me, because I consider myself part-time, I only have about 5 or 6 hours in the day that I can really devote to, you know, merch and eBay and Etsy and Amazon. So, you know, I'm juggling all of these things and YouTube.
And you YouTube. Know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, nice.
So, that, I mean, that may have to be something that next week I just sit down and start slapping labels on stuff, popping them in a box, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. And coming down with, I was trying to think about like a different type of like scheduling thing that I could try to work out. You know, like with YouTube, I try to get out like 2 videos a week and, you know, a lot of the subscribers are asking me like, when are you going to do like 3, 4, 5 videos a week? And, and I'm trying to, you know, trying to figure that out too, you know, what I want to do. And, I've done eBay
every day almost.
Oh yeah. Yeah. That's, that's crazy though. I mean, uploading every day on YouTube and then, you know, balancing everything else, maybe because, you know, there is so much opportunity now, it's kind of like trying to figure it out. But, yeah, I think it's going to be really coming down to like, what do I really, really want to do? But it's going to be hard, but I'm guessing that FBA might be the one that gets put on hold. Like, really? I've been doing eBay for so long that I guess I just got used to taking pictures and doing all the things with eBay and already have my templates and all that's ready. And I've been doing eBay, I think when I joined like in 2000 or something like that. It's been a good while when I joined it. So I don't know, FBA, I think also with a lot of their restrictions that have been coming up.
And they just keep changing like randomly, like, okay, now not this. And now, okay, never mind that, you know?
Yeah, it's been a little like, oh man, trying to follow through. And not, I mean, there's a lot of people that are just dominating every platform, like maybe really going hard on eBay and just dominating eBay, or really going through FBA and dominating that. And then, you know, but I guess with merch, I just love doing all of them. I think that's what's hard too. I love doing all of them and I don't have enough time in the day.
Yeah, absolutely. I completely understand that.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, is it my turn? Oh my gosh. I mean, with me, I mean, I think most people by now know that I do have a day job. So my time is very limited and, you know, I have a lot of, things going on at my day job currently, with projects and whatnot. And you know I've been really secretive about this in the past, and now the more I think about it, I don't know why. Anyway, my current day job is I work at Stanford University in California, in Palo Alto. So you know, I've been there for 12 years, and I'm working on a lot of projects there right now. But kind of like what Glenn said, you know, I'm like the complete opposite though. I'm not going to quit FBA because I enjoy FBA. I think once my merch by Amazon, and I've said this publicly already, I mean, once I can grow my numbers on merch to the point where I'm making 4 or 5K a month, I think I'm going to quit doing eBay altogether. And the reason being that is because it's just, I hate having the stuff in my house, you know, and I hate having to take the pictures and do the listing. And it's just, you know, the stuff's in your house, it's in the other room, and it's just taking up a whole lot of space. And that's something I don't want anymore. Right. I mean, again, if I can make my numbers grow on merch, which I see happening, in the long-term scenario, but until then, until that happens, I guess I'm still doing eBay. But I do want to quit it altogether. One thing I don't want to quit is Craigslist. I love selling on Craigslist. That's my second platform where I make the most money, believe it or not, even more than eBay. I mean, I make a significant income on Craigslist. Yeah. I'm always posting something on Craigslist. And that's cash in your pocket. You know, there's no fees, there's mm-hmm. no returns. You know, that's cold cash in your pocket.
Yeah. So. And that's what I think kind of like plays the difference between everybody and where they're also like, you know, their location. Craigslist for me is like, I always get the people that are like, oh yeah, I'll meet you right now. And then it's like 15 minutes later, 20 minutes later, then they never show up. And I'm like,
oh wow.
Man, you know what I could be doing with this time right now? So Craigslist in my area used to be really, really good. And then it kind of started like downgrading a little bit. I think OfferUp is kind of doing a little bit better in my area now. But I totally understand with not having to pay any fees or shipping anything. just get cash and meet somebody.
And I'm a lady, so I don't do a lot of Craigslist unless I have my husband's picture up there, my dad. A friend of mine was selling something on Craigslist, and a dude had a cab drop him off at their meet. I was like, no.
Oh wow, that's interesting. That's a new one.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I've never had any issues selling on Craigslist, and I've said this in the past. You know, when you do make a transaction, make sure you do it in a public location. Don't bring them to your house unless it's something big that you can't move by yourself. I don't think I'll ever stop doing Craigslist. But eBay in general, I just, it's a tedious task. I've been on eBay since 98, but it's just something that just, it's so frustrating sometimes.
Yeah.
And what about you, Margaret? If there's one of them that you would possibly let go, because let's say you're not going 100% on it because of merch or something else you added on, what would it be?
It would be Amazon. Yeah, FBA.
FBA?
As much as my husband would hate to hear that. He wants his stuff out of the house.
That's interesting. I'm just out of curiosity. I mean, both of you guys said FBA. FBA. Is there any particular reason why, though?
I'm on the hunt. I love the treasure hunt aspect of going out. You don't know what you're going to find. I'm not into RA a whole lot. Mm-hmm. So when I do find stuff for Amazon, it's usually like thrift stores or garage sales. So I never know what I'm going to find. So I think for me, it's more of that going out and finding that treasure, that gem, that something awesome that I wasn't expecting to find.
Mm. What about you, Glen?
The same thing. Because if you find like a vintage old school item that just like pops at you that you're like, what? I didn't expect to find this at all. It's worth, you know, something. But, you know, if you go to Target or Walmart, you kind of already know how much that thing's selling in the market. Mm-hmm. Of course, if you're selling a crazy item that you found or, you know, that you got for cheap too, let's say swap meet, garage sale or something, you paid $1 or $2. Retail, like I said, there's a lot of people killing it out there. I get it. But also your profits are going to be a lot less as far as like your return on investment because you're paying retail prices. And I don't know. That's a bad thing too, because where I live, there's so many retail stores. Like we have way more Walmarts and Targets than like any other thrift store. And that gets also kind of like, oh man, I should be out there doing some RA stuff. But that's probably why I would let go of FBA.
Okay. I mean, it is.
They change the rules like all the time, you know.
Yeah.
Like lately which is fine. It's their deal, you know. But
right. Well, actually, I mean, it's good that you bring that up. I mean, you obviously heard the episode where you heard about my account getting suspended.
Oh.
Is that scary? I mean, so for those of you guys that don't know, this is something that I talk about on our podcast. I believe it's episode 3. I don't want to take up the airtime and retell the story, but if you guys want to hear the story, go to on iTunes, find our podcast, and listen to episode 3. But my FBA account was suspended And it wasn't for my metrics. You guys have to hear the story. I wasn't doing anything illegal. It was something, in my opinion, that was very minor. I know I was out of town. My laptop had gotten stolen. I couldn't respond to Amazon's request in a timely manner. And my account was suspended. And when it got suspended, it was all across the board. My FBA account was suspended. My Kindle account was suspended. And my merch account was suspended. Like you said, I mean, there's a lot of restrictions, you know, and at the end of the day, you can call it your business, but it really isn't. They control you. They control your business.
My friend Nick Hills, who's in the chat, he's a UK reseller. And last year, I remember talking to him last year, you know, he'd send in all this stuff because he does FBA, and his account got suspended, and he was freaking out, you know? So it's just like that somebody's that much power over, and it was all up there already. So he couldn't have it recalled and sell it on eBay because it was already gone, you know?
Yeah. But go and listen to that episode and you guys will hear exactly what happened. It really is scary how much control that they have.
And that's what kind of relates to what we were talking about as far as like managing all of these platforms, because when you look at it, exactly what Yong said, they control it. Any one of these could go at any moment. So at that point, you know, if you gave up eBay and then you don't have a merch account anymore, you don't have an FBA account, then you're like, well, I guess I'll go back to eBay. But if you haven't done it in 3 or 4 months or maybe even longer, you might be like, I kind of don't want to do it because I've already been out of it. And that's the thing I kind of look at too, because I'm like, man, if I went 110% into merch, what would happen? But if I don't do YouTube or I don't do eBay or FBA or anything else, I'm like, something can happen and I'm going 100% into something, almost like that little scare that happened when people were like, oh, well, Sony, you can't sell Sony anymore. You can't sell Microsoft anymore. You can't sell this anymore, you know, on FBA. And it was like, oh man, 100% in FBA. What do I do now?
Yeah.
And you're like, I don't know.
Yeah.
I was at a conference recently and I met so many people that were 100% FBA. I'm just thinking, dude, what are you doing?
Well, you know, and you know, I've heard people say, well, your merch account is completely separate from your FBA account. And I've heard that, but I'm telling you from experience, when my FBA account was suspended, they suspended my merch account as well. So, you know, I'm telling you right now, it's not separate. They're all connected.
I mean, it's good to know. It's good information.
So do you want to talk, I guess, like if Margaret, if you want to talk a little bit about, you talked about your, I think last time too, you talked about your husband knowing a little bit about Illustrator. And so he's more into like FBA. Is that what you said, that he's kind of like, I don't know, more into FBA more than merch, but you're kind of convincing him more and more about it?
Well, he likes merch. He's he works for a shipping company and he's really busy. Right now he's not doing graphic stuff. He's doing front end, back end development. I don't even know. I laugh when I hear that, but
like, what is that?
I like back end. But anyway, sorry. But he's got a background in graphic design, so he keeps saying, "Oh yeah, I can help with these shirt designs." But yeah, he, as far as getting stuff out of the house, he would much rather be doing Amazon, sending all this stuff in, because I have the spare room is basically my work room where it's just like my stuff. But he is planning on doing Illustrator 101 with me, because he starts talking about random, before the show, you heard him talking to me about it. I'm like, I don't even know what that means.
Yeah.
Like, stop there. You know, but I feel like there's tons of people that have approved for merch and they are right there where I am. They have zero idea whatever that word was that he said. I don't even know what it
is. Yeah. Well, I mean, so, you know, and you and I were talking, Margaret, before the show, some of the more common questions that Glenn and I get is, oh, you know, I just got into merch. How do I use Illustrator or how do I use Photoshop? And we don't have a problem answering that question, but it's just, you know, there are thousands and thousands of videos online that you guys can watch for free that does a much better job explaining how to use those softwares than we can.
Yeah.
I mean, I can try and explain it to you, but trust me, I'm not that great of a teacher. Go watch one of these free videos, and it'll do a, you know, much better job than we can.
Right. And that's what we were talking about too, was that I have had people message me, like, I watch some of these Illustrator videos, and it's like these people, they know it so well that they don't realize they're skipping steps, or they're using acronyms that I don't know what these acronyms mean. And, you know, so I was telling Randy that, and he said, we're going to sit down and we're going to do this. We're going to do an Illustrator 101. And that's why I don't want him to tell me stuff, because then when we're doing the video, I can say, well, stop. What does that mean? I don't even know.
Yeah. And, you know, and just because, you know, Randy might do something, and, you know, Glenn and I talked about this in one of the episodes, just because he does something one particular way, you know, Glenn might do it another way. I might do it a different way. I mean, there's no right way to do something, long as the outcome is the same. And that's the beauty of Photoshop and Illustrator, is there's like a dozen ways of doing something. To get the same results.
And two, I mean, just goes to show you that I don't know Illustrator. I don't know Photoshop. I do my designs on other platforms, and I'm still making a pretty decent income off of it, you know?
Mm-hmm. What are you using?
I'm using PicMonkey, and then I'm using a couple apps. I'm using Over and WordSwag.
Okay, I never heard of PicMonkey. I have to take a look at it.
Where have we been, Yong?
Just kidding. Hey, man.
Yeah,
hey.
I made a tutorial.
I just got married. I just got married, and I was on the honeymoon.
You did not. Y'all are like, oh, no, sorry. What are you talking about?
I forgot. That was Glenn.
So I guess answer some of these questions. How do you get approved for merch? You can go to merch.amazon.com and you can sign up. Usually it takes about, I don't know, that's kind of thing, because I've heard some people maybe like 3 or 4 months. Some people have been waiting to get in for even longer than that. When did you guys join?
I joined right after I talked to you, which was this past December, and it took me about 3 to 4 months before my account was approved.
See, mine was December as well, and until I went back and looked at my numbers, I thought I didn't sell my first shirt till March. But when I went back and looked at everything, I must have gotten in pretty quickly, because my first shirt sold in January.
Oh, wow.
So I must have gotten in December.
Yeah, no, I was definitely approved in March, I think. March or April, I can't remember.
Really? And I think he's been waiting for a good while on his.
2 months, yeah.
Yeah. And I think, one of the questions I get a lot through email is there any way that you can get approved quicker? And I wish I had an answer for this, but most of the people that I've talked to, is just a waiting game at this point. I'm pretty sure they have a good amount of lists. I wish I knew a little bit more of like how they're choosing people, when they're choosing people, but I don't know of any quicker way, except that one time they did have a webinar that you could join.
That's right.
And they said that they would get people in for those people that signed up for the webinar and signed a certain form thing only for that day, I think. Even some of the people that signed up for that webinar, I think we're still waiting to get in. So I don't really know.
Yeah. And just as a disclaimer, Margaret, Glenn and myself, when we do these podcasts or videos, we're not here because we're claiming we're experts. We're just talking amongst ourselves, and sharing our journeys, into merch with you guys. So, sometimes you might not have the answer that you want, again, because we're not experts. We don't work for Amazon. Right. So for that particular question, unfortunately, we don't have an answer for that. We don't know.
I'm an enthusiast, is what I like to say.
Yeah, we're all along on the ride with you guys, trying to
get
everything in and make our numbers better too.
Exactly.
And I think another question was, if we trademark our designs, I think that would even take roughly about 2-3 months too, if you want to officially trademark your design through the trademark office, probably, Yong.
I think. I don't know how long the process takes. If I recall, I think it's $35. To trademark. Is it trademark or copyright? I can't remember. It's one of those.
I think it is a trademark. Uh-huh.
Okay, I think it's $35.
Trademark office.
it's a one-time payment, and I don't remember the length of the trademark. I think it's something like 65. It goes on to like 65 years until you, after you die or something. I don't have the exact numbers, but I think it's $35.
I thought it was more than that. I thought it cost more than that.
Well, let's see.
Well, I could be wrong. I'm just saying.
I think that's the copyright. I think
is
the copyright
or trademark? Is around $35. It's one of those.
I think it's officially trademark. I think that's like 250 around there.
Okay.
I think.
Okay. Yeah, you guys would have to look it up. I can't remember if it's trademarking or copyright. But it's $35, and then
I'm just thinking it would have to be like a really hot design for me to do that.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah.
And Trump might not approve if I
right.
If I copyright one of his quotes and.
And I think Jude has a good comment saying that if you've been selling on Amazon for a long time, you may have been approved for merch already. And that's the thing too, is that Amazon is very weird when it comes to this stuff. It's like, they're not going to send you in. Well, at least when I joined, they didn't even send me an email or anything telling me that I was in. I think the same thing happened to my brother. He just logged in and he was approved, but he didn't even know he was approved. So sometimes that happens too. Like, you just want to log in, double check if you're, if that page comes out to where you still have to keep applying, then obviously you're not in, but you just never know. It's always good to see, because they are a little weird like that.
Yeah, I didn't get an email.
Yeah.
I got an email like 10 times. You're approved. Really? You're approved. You're approved. You're approved. That's because I kept applying.
So. Oh, I did the same thing too. Yeah. I every week was like, am I in? One more time?
Yeah.
So.
I can't see the questions. So is there any more questions?
There were some. I'll have to scroll back up.
Yeah. Trademarks cost about $275 and up. So I was roughly around there. I think the trademark is around $250, $275. And then the copyright, I think, is like what Young was saying. That's like kind of like to get initially started, but it is kind of a long process to really get that going too. I think some of the people that wanted to get some ideas trademarked were kind of thinking about it. And it's like, well, 2 or 3 months later, if that, I don't know, saying isn't trending anymore, is it really worth it to get it trademarked? So personally, I wouldn't get anything trademarked. But you just have to be aware that if you are creating a t-shirt or something that is getting a little popular, you notice maybe other people taking your general idea, maybe they're creating their own version, of course, but that's just kind of part of the game, I think.
Yeah. Yeah. That's what somebody you guys, said. Like, go on.
I don't know. I was just going to see if you guys had... So we're all three of us are like on different tiers right now. And our experience, obviously, it's like very, very early in the merch game, only being about a year old or so. But what are some, like, if you can give like three, I guess, tips that you found right now that's, you know, helping you succeed with the things you're doing right now, what would it be on merch right now?
Margaret, you want to go first?
No, you go first.
You want me to go first? I'll go first. Three things. Three things that help with merch. Number one, don't copy. Don't ever copy. Mm-hmm. You can definitely get inspired by other designs, but don't ever copy. Let's see, what else? You know, I would say market your designs on social media. But I've had mixed results, so I don't know. So that's kind of like in between. That's like kind of like a gray area. Number three, you know, utilize what softwares that you have. You know, there was an episode on our podcast where we talk about the softwares. You know, if you're just getting started, there's nothing wrong with using GIMP, and obviously, Margaret, you use PicMonkey,
yeah.
You know, nothing against that, but the true professional designers do use Adobe. That is what is industry standard. That's what designers use most.
I agree. I'm going to learn it.
Yeah. So definitely educate yourself on those apps. That would be the three tips that I would give.
Okay, my turn.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. All right. So.
Let's hear it.
One, because I don't have a background in design or shirts or this kind of stuff. One, educate yourself, which is kind of like what Yong said. I mean, there's tons of information out there. There's Facebook groups, YouTube videos, especially now that merch is sort of taken off. It's been almost a year. You know, there are YouTube videos out there, people sharing their experiences. And, you know, for me, like, I don't have any background, you know. So if I'm able to do it, anybody can. Just get out there and learn it. Two, go with what you know. I mean, start making designs based around things that you're interested in, things you're that you know about. I mean, I was saying earlier, my son was helping me make designs tonight, and because he was telling me what he knew, and some of my kids' designs have sold, so that works. And then, oh gosh, three.
Glen, you put us on the spot, damn it.
I know. Sorry. It could be worse. It could be like, okay, Margaret, give me 10 ways. You know?
Give me your top 10 tips.
What are you, David Letterman here?
Of course, I have a third one, but my brain is just... But yeah, I mean, basically, for me, the big number one is get out there, talk to people, join, you know, Facebook groups that are based on merch, even if you're not in there yet, because you can... Where people are really tight with their ideas, they're really generous generally with how to get going and how to keyword and how to market and things like that. So,
very good. I think what I would say for sure, number three, would be to have patience, because things aren't going to happen overnight. And for sure, you're not going to get accepted overnight. At least not now, because of, you know, how many people have signed up. But even with you know, uploading designs, I get quite a bit of emails and people have asked like, hey, Glen, I just put up my first 5 designs. I haven't sold anything yet. And it's been 6 days. What's going on? And yeah. I'm like, you know, 5 designs, you know, like right now I have 2,800 designs. A lot of those don't sell, but there's quite a bit of them that are consistent. Now, those ones that are consistent, you know, they've been doing well. They've just kind of kept staying there and kind of growing everything. But the ones that don't sell, they're going to get knocked off pretty soon in the next day or two. So right now I'm playing like the numbers game. I don't know how long that will last. I haven't done any like marketing with like Pinterest or Instagram or anything. And Mike, that you guys just talked about, he was doing some marketing. So I do think that's eventually going to come into play, that you're going to have to start, you know, marketing more and more of your items. But really, patience is key, because it's not going to happen overnight. And as far as like, you know, big time numbers that, you know, you want to see, is not going to happen quickly, but you can build it up and grow it. Like I've seen Margaret and Joe like really, really growing it. And I like seeing their numbers, because I remember seeing Joe when he was selling like, you know, one or two a day. And then now he's like, you know, he'll send me messages like he did the other day, like, I sold 50 this week. And, wow. And, you know, and he doesn't have like a huge graphic design background either. He was playing around stuff. He would ask me to, you know, if I had like books or anything that I learned or anything that, you know, that kind of helped me when I was in graphic design school. And so I was telling him a little bit about that, but definitely patience. If you are in and you're in, you know, the system, you're at your 25 tier, from there, I would probably look into just trying to get the best designs and trending and things that you think people are going to be into, and not, you know, not just thinking about, I don't know, like random ideas that come to your head. I would really do some research, go through Pinterest. Maybe, like we said, the holidays are coming up, so that one might be a good thing to kind of maybe look into. So I would probably look into see like what things are that could sell. So you do a little bit about your homework and everything like that. And then once you're in, I think it really comes down to like, you know, great design, simple, bold design. And then your next part is pricing. Mike talked about, he had a lot of his are at like $16.99. Mine are a mix, like $17.99, $19.99. I don't have anything over $20, but some people do. Mm. Some of those have sold. I think $14.99 is a little too low, just because we talked about a little bit on the podcast that if it is really, really low, people might think it's like a counterfeit stolen design. Sometimes it happens. I think, oh, well, maybe it's like cheaply made or something, because a lot of people don't know if you're buying it. I don't think they really know. I mean, where it's coming from, that it's coming from.
They don't know.
that, you know, it's coming from Amazon, that they're making the shirt themselves. So they really don't know that, but for sure, designs and pricing, and then your keywords come into play. Same thing with emails. I've gotten them to where it's like, I don't know, like it'll just be like base, like a red, I don't know, red reindeer t-shirt. Red, but they're reindeer. Not adding in, yeah, like an example.
Kind of a reindeer was red.
Example.
I know a red nose reindeer.
Anyway, well, hold on. This is an example. But let's say if they're not saying like Christmas or holidays or snow or something like that, to try to put in these extra keywords, then if it's only like, I don't know, 3 to 4 words for their title, it's going to be very, very hard to find it. So now I just feel like I'm rambling. So go ahead,
Yong. I was explaining keywords to my son tonight, you know, because he was wanting to make this shirt. And he was like, why would I, you know, I just want to put, it was an airplane shirt. I'll just throw it out there. He was like, I just want to put airplane. That's it. Airplane shirt. That's it. I was like, nobody is going to find this, honey. We got to put in, like, let's think of some other words that have to do with airplanes. Yeah. Come on, let's go with this.
What would it be like jet, pilot,
aviator.
And so you got to
think about, and so we did a Google search, mm-hmm. and we're trying to figure out like what are some other words we could use.
I mean all those are good tips. I mean, you know, I started recently experimenting with the whole pricing. I know initially I was just pricing all my shirts at $19.99, and then I started changing some to like $18.99, $17.99. I don't price anything under $17.99. Do I think it helped? I'm sure it did. I mean, obviously I won't be on pace to make $1,200 if it didn't. But yeah, I mean.
Well, and I did, like, right when I had some of my shirts were about to get booted, I did do just an experiment. I went through and dropped the prices to $14.99 just to see if it would get a boost on any of them or a couple of them would sell. And I, you know, a couple of them did. And so then it's like, okay, well now I can, I just, you know, out of curiosity, just to see, is this
going to happen? Yeah, we'll get this. So I did the same thing just to see what would happen. And Glen, you obviously heard this story because we talked. Most of my shirts that were about to get deleted, I dropped the prices to $11, okay? The royalty on $11 on merch is 4 cents. Not one sold. Not one. No.
Wow.
So I don't know. It's,
but I think you're right. I mean, I think that $16.99 is probably.
Yeah.
Because I didn't see a big jump because I dropped basically all of them that were about to get kicked off.
I think. Well, I don't price mine under $17.99, but I mean that just goes and proves you. Prove to you that just because you lower your price doesn't mean your shirts are going to sell. I haven't sold one of my $11 shirts, not one, at least not yet. I haven't logged in since we started the show, but yeah, not one. And but yeah, those are all good tips. I mean, just in overall, I would say follow the rules. Don't risk your account. They do suspend it. You know, I learned firsthand from my experience that they will suspend your account. And again, mine was for a very minor thing. So
I agree. I mean, the suspension thing just freaks me out. And my husband will come to me and say, I know, let's do a shirt too legit to quit. I'm like, I'm pretty sure that's not okay.
Yeah. Just you know, just comply with everything that Amazon tells you. I've said this in the past, you know, ignorance is not an excuse. I find that most people, they always say, oh, I didn't know. Well, it's your responsibility to go in and read the terms of services every now and then.
And I did.
Because they change all the time.
Sorry. There was a question that came in about how many rejections have we received. And this kind of goes along with what you were saying, because I uploaded all these football shirts. I may have told you the guys this story before, but I uploaded all these random like football shirts. But in the description, I put perfect for your Super Bowl party. And I uploaded like 12, 15 shirts all at one time.
Wow.
And then it was like, I got all of them rejected and I freaked out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And if you guys read those emails, I mean, I think I've been rejected maybe like a half a dozen times now. And then most of them were for just keywords, kind of like you. Mm-hmm. And if you, again, we don't have the answers. We don't know how many times it'll take before you, Amazon takes action. But if you guys do read the email, it does say, if it happens 2 months, that they will suspend your account. It says it right there in black and white. So make sure you always read everything that Amazon sends you. That was part of the reason why my account was suspended. Again, you know, go to episode 3 of our podcast to hear that story.
And that's what's kind of crazy, though, is just that, okay, so you don't get the email that you've been accepted into the program, and then you don't really know when you could get kicked off because of rejections. So, yeah, I think kind of like with everything, I mean, you are kind of just, I don't know, like kind of very, very cautious when it comes to like these little things. As far as like, so how many rejections have you guys had? Margaret, you said you had like 15 in that one time that you uploaded them. So it is kind of good and kind of promising, though, that you didn't get kicked off for the 15 and know that, hey, 15 right off the bat, well, at least in your case, will not get you kicked off. So it is good to hear and good to know.
Yeah, yeah. I was really sweating, though, because, I mean, like you say, it's just, this is such a good opportunity, and you don't know when it's going to stop. I mean, like y'all said before, they could decide tomorrow, well, we tried this, we don't like it, never mind, we're game over. Nobody, you know, they could decide that anytime they want, you know. So, trying to get this car paid off before they decide that.
Yeah, tell me about it. My goodness.
Trying to milk this for all it's worth. And another question, can you put a deleted or drop design back up at a later date as a new design?
Wait, does that mean that they're going to redesign it, or is it the same design and they're just going to re-upload it?
I think it's probably a question for when they get booted off. And I think for those questions, at least the answers that I've seen, is that you will have to create a new listing for it. And you won't be able to just click like a 1-2 button thing saying
relist,
you know, to relist or to renew it. You'd have to create a brand new listing and then re-upload that design.
Go through the whole process. Yeah.
Again. Yeah.
Do you have many that you'll do? I have some that I'll probably do that for. I mean, I've mentioned this before. Like, I have some shirts that are Zodiac based. And some of them have sold and some have not sold because it's like not that time yet for that sign. But I was just thinking, okay, maybe like 2 months before Capricorn comes around, maybe I'll re-upload the Capricorn shirts that I've got, and you know,
I don't know. I think it'd be kind of crazy too to see, I guess, what happens. But I would probably just try to make it better too, because I was going through my other ones that are pending right now that are going to get kicked off in the next couple of days, and I was kind of going through them like, how can I make that design better, or should I just move on and just come up with new ideas? Yeah, so I don't know. I'm gonna have to.
Majority of mine are like that. Okay, time to cut. You know, scrap them. Start over something new.
I mean, but they do say that you can buy your own shirt to make it live. So. Yeah, I mean that is an option. What you could do is just lower the price to $11, like I did, and then just buy your own shirt. I guess you can go that route if you don't want to get it.
You have 2,400 shirts up.
Oh yeah, no, forget about it. No, I'm not buying 2,400 shirts. Heck no.
And I guess as far as like the rejected designs, what about the other part to where they get kicked off because of copyright? How many designs have you guys gotten kicked off? Because of trademark and copyright issues later on.
Oh gosh!
Like after they've been live, they got kicked off.
After they've been live.
Oh, none. I did have one that I adjusted. Like I was like, oh, I'm gonna adjust this one a bit. And when I sent it back through to, because you know you have to, it repends. Like let's say I'm dropping the price on it, and they take it through the process again. It didn't get accepted the second time around.
Okay.
So, but I've never had one that they found. I dread that if they find it.
Yeah. No, that I don't think that's happened to me. You know what's happened to me was I got one email from Amazon saying, "Hey, this person has complained that you copied their design or something. And what it said was, they didn't pull that shirt, but they said, they gave me their contact information and said, and the email said, please contact them and then you guys can work it out amongst yourself.
Yeah.
And that has to do with intellectual property. We can, you know, that's a whole nother topic right. that we can get into. But so, and you know, I've never seen her shirt before, his or her shirt. So what I did, I mean, it was just coincidence. That's my guess, obviously. So what I did was, instead of just contacting them, I just deleted the shirt. That's all I did.
Right. Yeah. And well, then I mean, I've gotten probably quite a bit. I hadn't had any rejections. I haven't gotten any rejections yet. But later on, when they're live and things like that happen, and then someone does copyright something, then you can get your shirt taken off, because then they trademark it or copyright it. Then you'll get that email if they want to get it. I know there was one shirt that was really, really selling good, and then I double checked it, like, this was like months later, 6 or 7 months later, and during that time I had maybe like 3 pages full of this one shirt. I double checked it months later and there was like 5 designs left. Mine was one of them, and I was like, man, how come this shirt has like spiked up? And I looked it up, it was 5 left, and then I looked up the trademark, and sure enough, someone had trademarked. And so I took it off before I could get that email, but I've gotten at least maybe like 20 different shirts taken off later on,
but
like months later.
See, but the thing is and again, you know, I'm not an expert in this, but if they copyrighted or trademarked that particular caption or slogan or whatever after you uploaded yours, I mean,
yeah.
I mean, again, I'm not an expert. I guess we would have to talk to like an attorney about that. But I mean, would that still take effect? So I don't know. I mean, a good story on that for me to share is, I used to know a person. She used to have a sports memorabilia store named Upper Deck, but she had that store since before Upper Deck even existed. And then she was telling me that she received a letter from Upper Deck saying, you need to change your name. And she's like, I'm not going to change my name, because she's like, I've had this name long before you guys even existed. So she went to the whole legal issue, and the lawyer at the end of the day told her, yeah, you don't have to change your name because you had this particular name long before Upper Deck came around. So, but again, I'm not a, you know, don't say, oh, well, young sir, don't, you know, don't take my advice. Okay. I'm just telling you, I'm just sharing the story.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I mean, if they copyright something after you uploaded it, I don't know. I mean, that's something that we should look into.
Yeah,
I think for sure if they do the trademark office and they pay for it and they get it through the whole thing, you do have to remove your business name or idea or anything like that in general, because now they paid for it to go through the whole system. So I'm pretty sure that's exactly how it's going to work. You're going to have to take your stuff down, even though you already had it before they did.
Yeah. And sort of on topic, sort of slightly off topic, I took y'all's advice where you were talking about graphics on Etsy. And what was it, the last episode or episode 6? I can't remember, 6 or 7. And so I was started looking on Etsy, and I found somebody who had graphics up, and I messaged her. And so she and I have been working on her creating some designs for me, kind of like you would like Fiverr. Yeah. I'm trying to get her to tweak this contract that she's sending me, you know, like, oh yeah, you can use it for commercial use for shirts, you know? And so she sent me this contract. I'm like, can you tweak the contract a little bit just to make sure that it says print on demand and like just to cover myself. So if later she comes back and's like, whoa, I really missed the boat on this one. I want my designs back, you know? So just something to think about.
Exactly. I think some of the questions, I think we're kind of a little bit behind. But so Linda asked, how do we prepare for the shirts to be removed by Amazon? Will they put them in a file, or do we need to know when each design is dropped so we can file it away?
It tells you, you know, pending removal, you know, you have 17 days left before they remove it. So it tells you.
And I think they said that they would just leave, they'll still leave the shirt on there. You can see the small little thumbnail and
in the dashboard
title. Yeah, in your dashboard. And I think just the title. I don't think you can like go through and edit and do all that over again. So it's just going to show you those two things, and that's it.
I've gone through and I took a screenshot of the shirt with all, because so I can remember what my keywords and descriptions were. I mean, if it were one that I re-uploaded or tweaked, then I would have some of the information. However, I may want to rethink that if it didn't sell, but at least I would just kind of peace of mind, like, okay, I know what I put there, and or maybe what I won't put next time. I don't know.
Cool.
Is there a way to check to make sure your design isn't a copy before you list it?
You mean like the actual words or the actual design? If it's the actual design, I don't know of any way you can really check that.
One of the designs this lady sent me, just to make sure, I did a Google reverse image search on it, just because I'm a nerd like that. And I wanted to make sure, like, I don't see the same exact thing, pixel for pixel, popping up on me. So I did that, and then just trademark, like, check out.
Yeah,
I'd probably say the combo of both of those.
You know, it's that whole copyright trademark thing. It's such a complicated issue because, I mean, in the whole art and design industry, like, everything's been done at some point, even if it just slightly different, everything's been done. So, you know, even if someone creates something and it kind of looks like yours, doesn't mean that they actually copied it. I mean, it's just such a complicated topic.
Now,
if they copy pixel for pixel, which has happened to one of my shirts before, well, then that's a whole different story. But I mean, you know, it's if you want to take them to court, you can, but you have to prove, you have to somehow prove that they copied your design or someone else's design. And it's just a complicated process. It really is.
Yeah. And kind of going on to that, they had asked, you know, who owns the designs once they are done for merch? If my daughter designed them, does she retain all rights?
That depends on the contract.
I've heard this one before.
Yeah. The contract.
No, it really does. It really does, right? I mean, depends on how the contract is written up. I mean, obviously, a mother-daughter.
The design's mine.
You know, obviously, a mother-daughter wouldn't have a contract, but if you have a designer, if you hire a designer, it just depends on how the contract's written.
Yeah, I think if you're just.
Oh, go on.
Oh, go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, I do like how on Amazon, I was looking through their, you know, frequently asked questions, and you can upload your designs on other platforms, and they're, you know, so right now, it's cool. You know, they could change that, but.
Yeah, true. Right now, they're fine. And then that's the thing, too, because their terms and conditions change. I mean, we've had, like, two shows just on, like, terms and conditions because they've changed, like, that frequently between, like, 2 or 3 weeks that you're like, oh, now you can do this, and then now you can't. And, you know, that's just part of the game, too. And as far as the question goes, I think that if you're the original artist, you do own your right to your shirt. So if someone does make a copy pixel by pixel, like Yong said, of your design, then yeah, you can follow, you can, you know, do that whole thing with Amazon and type in the full details on that to get that shirt taken down. But a lot of people have had trouble with that too. And kind of like what Mike said, I think when you guys were talking about him, he thinks that when you're uploading a design that they really don't really look at the design because they're just kind of really looking for the keywords. Because I know, you know, Amazon's not going to go through this design by design to check
stuff.
Yes.
So they're looking for keywords. That's mostly what they're looking for now. But I think later on they will look for like pixel by pixel design.
I was at Ecom Chicago and Chris Green was there talking about it, and he was there for merch, and he was talking about, come on. I mean, Amazon has that screen cap, like, what is it? The little thing that it does where it, what's the thing called?
Y'all? What?
You know, when you like with Amazon and it's got the picture and a cap, picture capture, what is it called? Image capture or whatever?
Screen capture.
You know what I mean? Where it can recognize what like the cover of the movie is or whatever it is. But he was like, come on, Amazon has got this technology. Pretty soon they're going to apply it to merch and they're going to know, if it's a, you know, so. It's something that I think may be coming down the line.
Yeah, but I mean, oh gosh, I mean, again, I mean, that just opens up a whole nother can of worms, right? Because now you can get into parody, right? Because, like, you know, if you make a shirt that says, I mean, for instance, the Straight Out of Compton, you know, I see a lot of shirts that says Straight Out of Los Angeles, Straight Out of San Francisco. Again, that's a whole other issue. I mean, it's, you know, from my understanding, the law says with parody, typically you can get away with it. At least that's what I was told by my professor when I was in college. They said, as long as you're not out there to intentionally harm the original designer or company, parody is okay, but you just never know.
Yeah.
And again, this is just such a complicated topic, you know, the copywriting, the parody.
We're not lawyers.
Yeah, I mean, we can talk for days.
Yeah, tell that story to my lawyer, Young.
Send him my way.
See if that flies.
You know what? Send him my way. I'll send him to my professor back in college.
And I'll send him to Weird Al.
Yeah, Weird Al, the king of parodies.
Yeah.
Merch Profits, if you do own the rights or the trademark, how do you tell Amazon that you actually own it when you're uploading that design?
Well, they don't ask you for it.
Yeah, probably. Yeah, they don't ask you for it. It probably wouldn't come down to actually like using any of that information unless you see the copycats.
Yeah.
Then you're going to report it. Then you would put on there when you filed the trademark. You can also keep in mind, like, when you uploaded that shirt, it does give you that date.
Mm-hmm.
Keep that email because Amazon will send you an email. Hey, so-and-so shirt just got processed and now it's live. So I would keep that email too, just so you let everybody know that, you know, just in case that comes into play, you have it dated in writing when it got accepted and processed. So
yeah.
The next one, let's see. Should we have a file or copy from any graphics or fonts that we use for merch saying we have the rights to use them? How do you protect yourself?
What was that? Something about what?
Should we have a file or copy from any graphics or fonts that we use for merch saying we have the rights to use them? How do you protect yourself?
I think she's asking about the license. Yeah. I mean,
the license.
If you have a license, you should always save those. Because that's your proof to Amazon or whoever says, why are you using my font or why are you using my graphics? And we're like, well, I have the premium license. Here it is.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so always save those.
Yeah, that's why I'm trying to get that lady to change the wording just a little bit on that contract with me. Like, I just want to make sure, you know, just in case, you know, or I really enjoyed that podcast you guys did when you were talking about that. Like, just because it's free doesn't mean it's free. You know what I mean? You need to double check. Yeah. Check that commercial license and see, you know, is it how many 500 run or is it,
always read the license. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. There's, and that's every site, even person, freelancer has different, you know, agreements that you would have. So yeah, definitely get that for commercial use. And I wonder what they're going to say too. Does your, I guess, person know anything about merch or do you think they're just like strictly on Etsy right now?
Well, yeah, they're just on Etsy right now and they are just interested in doing, you know, like Circuit Cut or whatever she does.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
You know what I mean? Like decals. Yeah. So all she does is decals. She's like, I don't care how you use it as long as you're not doing decals and competing with me. I was like, well, let me just, you know, and I wanted to be completely upfront with her. You know, I'm planning on using the design for, you know, print on demand shirts and, you know, I just want to make shirts. I just wanted to be completely transparent with her with everything of what I'm going to do with it. So we'll see. I'm hoping it'll work out because she's got some nice designs. And I did, you know, I asked her, are these your original designs? And I did Google reverse image.
And just one tip I have on that is I know a lot of people that download free fonts, even though they're premium fonts. You know, there's bootleg websites out there. That's stealing, guys. Come on, okay? Pay for the font if you're going to use it, okay?
Yeah.
There's a lot of reputable websites out there where you can purchase them. Some of them are a little pricey, but you just don't want to risk your account. It's not worth it.
Yeah. And it is going to cost. I mean, it's, to work with her, it is going to cost money. But I like her designs. I like her style. And so I feel like I'm willing to build that relationship with her and pay the money it's going to take, you know, because I'm not, and I showed it to my husband. He's like, I can do that. I'm like, well, I can. You don't work all day.
Oh man.
Be like selling on merch, huh? And then start like searching into it. You're like, hey, can't get accepted that easy. Just
cool. Anything else?
Yeah. Oh yeah. There's more, Yong.
Where yeah, because I can't see the questions. I don't have that window up.
Oh, okay. I thought you wanted to leave or something.
No.
Yeah. Get that jacket on because there's a lot of questions.
My heater still hasn't kicked in. I don't know what's going on.
Would it help keep the copycats away if we add a trademark TM on our merch page or design somewhere?
Oh gosh, I don't know if that'd help, but I guess it would. I mean, I guess it would discourage some people.
What I've seen some people do is like add in like your business name. So like, let's say you're, you know, Texas Scout Treasures is your business name on merch and you have your certain line of t-shirts. You can add that kind of small on your design if you want to. So if someone buys it, they'll see it. It's on there. Yeah. So if some people do want to copy it, then they're going to try to get rid of probably your name on there because they want to use your design pixel by pixel. But then again, some other people might that want to buy it might get a little discouraged. Like, I really don't want that little their name on there or something. Mm-hmm. So that could work. But if you put a TM on there, doesn't mean it's actually trademarked because you didn't go through the whole process. They could look it up and see and be like, hey, well, this isn't even really trademarked. Well, they put a TM, but but it's not really trademarked through the trademark office. So they would probably still copy it anyway.
They probably copy it anyway. They didn't care.
Margaret's right. I mean, people don't care until their account gets suspended. They're like, oh my gosh.
Oh, yeah. I can't even imagine that. Like, why? There's like a billion ideas in the world. Why? Yeah. I mean, I guess you don't have to think, but.
Yeah, there's a lot of ideas. So many ideas that it just, man, I'm thinking like how to fill up all of this 8,000.
I wish I had that problem. Yeah. Sorry.
I mean,
show's over. Good for us.
I don't have time. Like, I text myself all day. If I'm out and I'll see something, I'll text myself the idea. So I have like my text messaging for myself is going nuts, but I don't have the time to make the shirts. I guess I can send them to you since you have 8,000 slots open.
Apparently, oh my gosh.
I think there was one guy that had 7,700 something. I think he was close to getting there, which I have no clue. I don't even know.
Yeah, I can only imagine what his payout's like. Jeez.
Oh yeah. I think he was making like 12 grand a month or something.
I hate him.
You hate him?
I hate him.
I see that and I'm like, yes, I will be there.
I know. One day I will be there.
Conquer.
And I will rule the world.
Yeah. Exactly. Because then if you think about it, if they do, I mean, I know it's all speculative, but if they do open it up to like mugs and phone cases and tote bags and whatever.
Oh,
like,
gosh. Yeah.
You've already got your foot in the door, you know. That's why I really am like, let me get teared up before next year because I really want to
have
my foot in the door for that. Because that's where big money starts coming in.
Exactly. I want to see where year two of merch goes. It's either they're going to add that stuff or maybe they'll start adding the out of the country sales.
Right.
Which either one of those is going to boost it up even more. But I want to see. Hopefully that comes year two, one of those. But who knows? It's still.
Who knows? Right,
they don't ship out of the country, right?
No.
Yeah.
It's just U.S.
In Canada. Someone was in Canada was like, I can't even ship. Well, you guys were interviewing him, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Daniel.
Daniel. Yeah.
He's like, I'm making stuff I can't even get in Canada.
Yeah.
And I think he was in the chat earlier. He, you know, he's in the UK and he's like, oh, I wish, please send, you know, get merch over here.
They're dying for it.
They see what's going on over here and they want it so bad.
Oh, man. Well, I mean, that's a good question, though. I mean, as a business, though, can Nick have a merch business account? Because Daniel surely does, and he's in Canada.
I think it's the money part, though. Like, how is he, you know, getting the money?
Okay.
Even though he's on FBA, I don't know. But
I'll tell you what, Nick. We can use my checking account, Okay.
Oh, no, don't trust me. Trust me.
I'm playing.
Your designs. I promise I'll give you some money.
I'll keep all the royalties.
That's the way it's
I'm playing. I'm playing, but yeah. So yeah. But
on the webinar, they did say that though, with getting rid of USA on your listing, like made in USA.
Yeah.
To get rid of that, so they kind of already hinted though. They said that if we're starting to make these out of the country, you know, we don't want you to have made in the USA. So they kind of hinted that already. So I'm thinking that's probably going to be the next one is like worldwide sales.
That would be so awesome.
I know. This would be huge, huge thing for merch. Yeah.
Because also it would open up a lot of other niches. You know what I mean? Like things that people in Canada or Mexico or the UK would be interested in buying, because then you're really opening up your ideas on what kind of shirts to make, you know?
Yeah, exactly. For sure. And I think, oh man, what is the other one? Oh, sorry. I was trying to go back on all these like questions. Oh, do you have a filing system in place to keep track of all your designs?
Yeah.
Are they numbered or question mark?
What do you do?
Well, first of all, I save everything on the cloud, because there's a good reason for that. My laptop was stolen not too long ago. And the only thing that saved me was everything on my personal files, on my merch files was on the cloud. That was the only thing that saved me. First of all, yeah, save on the cloud. The way I file it is, for instance, I'll just use a whole Straight Outta Compton example. If I designed a shirt that said Straight Outta Compton, I would create a new folder that says Straight Outta Compton, and then just put all my files in that folder, and then so on. You know, and then if I made a shirt that said Straight Out of Texas, you know, I'll create a folder that says Straight Out of Texas, and put all my files for that particular shirt in that file, in that folder. So that way, it just keeps everything organized.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And just a good pro tip. When you guys do something like that too, make sure you have a text file. I don't care if you guys use Word or just a notepad on your computer. Keep track of what font you used, okay? Because when you, and Glenn, you obviously know this, when you turn your, obviously, Margot, this ain't gonna make sense to you, but when you convert your font into outlines, you're going to lose all that information as far as what font you used. So you want to keep tabs of that, because if you ever want to go back or if you lose that particular design, now you have that text file that says, oh, okay, so that was Times New Roman or that was Helvetica. That's what I do. So that way I keep tabs of all my fonts that I used.
That's good. And I have to say, since I listened to the podcast where you got your laptop stolen, all of my designs are on my laptop. And so when I heard that, I was like, oh. And so I started uploading everything to the cloud after that. So all of my stuff now I have uploaded to the cloud, because that freaked me out.
And by the way, episode 3 as well.
What is wrong with this guy?
I can give you a long list what's wrong with me.
That's I got the pictures to prove it.
There's a long list.
Those pictures out.
Good. I'll make shirts out of them. Give me that list. Just kidding. And I think that's great tips too. And I think whether it's a cloud or a Google Drive, you can add them on there. You can get a separate hard drive for it too. You know, get it at Best Buy or something, or order it on Amazon to get a certain hard drive just for that.
No,
always back everything up though.
Yeah, I mean, there's nothing wrong with an external drive, but I highly recommend the cloud. I pay a premium price for it for a good reason, for stuff like that. You know, again, when my laptop got stolen, and you know, not only is it on the cloud, but all that stuff, all your files on the cloud, that's backed up by whoever company that you're using. So there's no real reason for an external hard drive, but I highly recommend the cloud. Dropbox, was it Google Drive or Box? You know, there's a bunch of them out there.
Yeah. I mean, that's what I'm using now is Google Drive, because it's 16 gigs, I think, is what you get.
Mm-hmm.
Something around there.
I pay $99 for a terabyte on Dropbox.
That's the year, right?
Yeah, annual.
And that's pretty cheap. I mean,
yeah, it's dirt cheap. Yeah. It's a business expense too.
Yeah.
I'm going to write that off at the end of the year.
That's a good question too, because I'm actually going to meet with my accountant on Friday to try to figure out, now that the year is ending, what's exactly going to happen. So that's a good question I kind of want to ask you guys, as far as what are you guys going to do as tax time comes around, and what you've made for merch, and with everything else, Etsy, eBay, FBA, has the merch thing kind of changed because you're not necessarily putting in money like you would with everything else? You're kind of spending more time maybe designing or listing when it comes to merch, but not necessarily spending a lot of money. So I guess, what do you guys think? Or
Well, I mean, there are expenses though, right? I mean, again, you know, we talked about buying fonts. You know, don't go to these bootleg websites and try and download free fonts. You know, buy your fonts. Okay, that's an expense. You know, like Margaret, you know, she's buying vector graphics on Etsy. That's a business expense. But yeah, I mean, I don't think the write-offs are as much as, you know, doing an FBA business or an eBay business, right? Because now we're not driving to a thrift store, right? Where we can write off the mileage and stuff like that. So it's a little tricky. Yeah. I mean, the best advice is, as always, you know, just talk to an accountant and figure out what you can write off.
And I'm in the process, like, I really like my accountant, but at the same time, she's sort of learning with me about the whole online business stuff.
Yeah, it's tricky. It really is
so
tricky.
I need to find somebody who knows, who's a little more, you know, like, because when I go to her to talk to her about the money I'm making for merch, she's going to be learning it right along with me, you know. Like, what do we do now? Okay, let's figure this out.
Yeah,
I'm going to have to get Donald Trump's accountant to see how I can get some kind of tax break now.
Oh, my gosh. Glenn's going to jail. Glenn's going to jail.
With what's going on. Just kidding.
He's going to jail. Oh, my gosh.
Friends will take care of him.
Well, that's a good point, too, because, like, when Mike was saying that he's advertising on Instagram and all that, too. So I think for year number two for me, I guess you guys want to talk about what you want to do as far as next year, and then we'll probably call it a show. But what you want to do for next year, for merch, year number two, going into how you want to improve or what you want to do. For me, definitely it would be finding time, some way that I can market and advertise the designs, because I haven't done that yet. And I think it's really going to come into play, and you know, as merch grows, and that's just going to be a numbers game where I can just upload a bunch of, you know, shirts, and hopefully they get a sale organically. I think time will happen, but who knows?
Okay. Margaret, you want to go?
Sure. For the next year, I mean, I've just started doing some advertising, and I'm still learning. I've been talking to Mike, who's Treasure Gnome. I know we've mentioned him a few times. His channel is called The Treasure Gnome. So he does some merch videos. So I've been talking to him on the side, like, okay, I'm doing this. It's not getting the result. You know, so he's kind of giving me ideas along the way. He's not going to give me exactly, because he was going to work in competition with each other, right? So, learning a little more. It's just me having to learn it, like figure out how I'm going to manage that marketing with the shirts, and just getting myself more, you know, getting myself bumped up and designing, learning how to design better on Illustrator, basically.
I mean, with me, it's, you know, it's just pretty much down the board. I mean, I just want to scale. I want to get to the next tier level, and I don't see, you know, I'm always afraid about social media marketing, because if I put my design out there, I'm just afraid someone's going to take it, because you know, the copycats are out there. Okay, say what you want, they're out there. So I'm always, I've been really picky about what I put on social media these days. But I mean, at the end of the day, I just want to scale up, man. I just want to design as much shirts as I can, because I think we can all agree that this is pretty much a numbers game, right? You know, just like anything else, right? You know, like FBA, the more you have, the more designs we have, the more money we're going to make. So,
yeah, exactly.
That's my goal.
Yeah, and I also want to also add to that, I just want to get like really, really organized when it comes to managing all of these. Linda had another question. If you have several businesses, have you started really focusing on one over the other during Q4? And we kind of talked about that a little bit in the beginning.
Yeah.
And like, really it's like merch is like my main thing right now. Merch I've been doing more than anything. Like I said, if this was last year, it would be really like FBA. I was just like Target, Walmart, Kohl's, Toys R Us, nonstop, just like getting a bunch of stuff, selling it. But right now it's like really, really going on merch. And then YouTube is like, YouTube and eBay are like my other two, which I'm trying to figure out, you know, too. And I'm not going to give it up because I love doing all that stuff too. I love like finding stuff, whether it's like Ross or thrift stores or something. And we actually had like a sneaker thing recently in my town, and a couple of like subscribers, you know, they said what's up to me, like, oh yeah, I like your channel and everything. They're like, but I don't watch any of your like merch videos though. And I'm like, that's totally understandable because you're into like the shoe stuff.
Yeah.
So I'm like, man, I got to figure out some way to kind of like balance this out.
I agree. Cause mine, oh, I just realized I have Yong presenting this whole time.
What?
Sorry, Yong. Yeah, I totally agree about the, a lot of my videos lately have been a lot more merch based.
Merch, yeah.
And my,
I noticed that too.
A lot of the people that watch my videos come for the thrifting and the hauls and the sales and
mm-hmm. Etsy and
yeah, so it's a more of a balance. But I think, you know, there's a lot of people that are hungry for information, so they're gonna come. They're gonna find you, you know.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's, I mean, and that's the beauty of it, right? I mean, we're all doing different things, different businesses, right? I mean, we've always talked about, you know, don't put all your eggs in one basket. You know, that's the common phrase that goes around in the whole reselling community, right? It's always good to diversify and do different things.
Yeah, definitely. And Linda's question, probably the last one before we go, where do we like to promote our merch shirts? I haven't done any promotion yet. That's what I want to work on next year. I think both of you, Yong and Margaret, have done Instagram, right? At least
I've done Instagram.
Posting it on
there. I've done Instagram. I've done one Facebook ad that hasn't done anything except just get likes on my damn picture on Facebook. That's all.
I've done some on Pinterest too, a little bit on Pinterest. Yeah. Okay. But I want to be real careful about that because I don't want to put it on my Texas Gal page because I don't want my followers there to think I'm spamming them. So it's real tricky, you know what I mean?
So
it'd be like managing different pages now because you're gonna be managing that one and then now like a new shirt one. So that's what I'm gonna have to be doing too. And
I did on Instagram. I just made a whole separate Instagram.
Yeah. That's what I did for Instagram. I have a completely different account.
And now I got a lot of deer people, hunting people following me. Cause like
that's right.
Nice.
So if I go out there to Houston, will you take me hunting?
Sure. What kind of hunting you want? Big game, big hair.
Spiders, maybe some caterpillars.
Sure.
Small hunting.
Cool.
Spiders. Small game
hunting. Yeah, small game hunting.
We'll get you one of those marshmallow guns.
Oh, gosh. Yeah. Yeah. Watch out. Don't mess with me. I'm going to really hurt you now. Cool. Okay, is that it?
That's it. Right. I think we're good.
Well, Margaret, you want to close it out? You know, I mean, I can have a, you know, I'll say my portion of my portion of the goodbyes, but I mean, we can close it out. But guys, thank you so much for watching. Glenn and I and Margaret, we really appreciate you guys tuning in. I know, you know, it's hump day. You know, it's, you know, everyone's kind of looking forward to the weekend. So we really, really appreciate you guys taking the time to tuning in.
Absolutely.
Yeah, Glenn, you want to say your byes?
Let's say my byes.
You want to say your farewells, man? What's up?
Yeah,
we're fading.
Thanks everybody for watching. And that what?
I said you look like you're fading.
I know. I was trying to type in this because they were asking me stuff about Mike. Mike will actually be a guest, I think, on the next show or the one after that.
Yeah.
So I don't have a link to his info, but I think you could just go straight to his website. You can look him up, Treasure Gnome. You should be able to see his website or his YouTube channel. Pretty sure you can find it from there. But he will be a guest coming up very, very soon on the podcast. So
good stuff. Yeah. All right. Yeah. Thanks everybody for coming over to watch. And I'm so grateful for you guys having me on your podcast because I love it.
Well, we're on your YouTube channel though.
Well, I know, but technically, you know, and I had so much fun. I appreciate y'all being game on my silly thumbnail that I made.
That was fun. That was fun.
It was good.
And, you know, this is an honor. You know, you've never had me as a guest on your channel before, so this is the first time.
Have I not? I guess not you either, Glen.
Yeah, oh, I know. So, man, this is
awesome. I haven't asked any wacky questions or anything.
Yeah. that's for the next show, right?
Next time. We will. I'll get some questions ready.
So let's try to do something. I don't know. Let's see what our progress is like. You know, later on, we can kind of see.
And yeah, we'll get check this one and see what we're doing.
Maybe we can do like a Valentine's Day show.
All right, there we go.
Oh, Glen, will you hug me?
Hey.
Oh, man.
Virtual hug.
There we go.
Cool.
All right. Thanks, you guys. And thanks, everybody, for coming to watch in the chat.
Bye-bye.
Thanks. See you.
Bye.